Okay, can everybody have a seat, please? I'm Dr. David Battinelli, the Dean of the Zucker School of Medicine, and I would like to welcome our students, invited guests, families, faculty, and esteemed guests to our 13th White Coat Ceremony, a truly special and proud time for all involved. Before we get started, I'd like to acknowledge several members of the stage party and guests. First, President Susan Poser, President Hofstra University. Dr. Kathy Reeves, President and CEO of the Gold Foundation. Dr. Lawrence Smith, our founding Dean and Dean Emeritus. Dr. Saranjit Ahuja, Dr. Carmen Rodriguez, and Dr. Ellen Perlman, our faculty leads for the Gold Humanism Honor Society. And welcome all our other participants of the program and all our deans who are here on stage with us. We'd like to also welcome some of our guests in the audience. Elizabeth Cleek, the Gold Foundation Senior Vice President and Chief Operating Officer, who's always been here. Mr. Ralph Nappi, the School of Medicine Joint Board Trustee and Northwell Health Trustee. Margaret Crotty, Chair of the Northwell Health Board of Trustees. Charlie Reardon, Provost, Hofstra University. Jean Payton Krista DeLu, Senior Advisor and Chief of Staff to the President of Hofstra University. And Chanda Washington, Associate to the President for Government and Community Affairs. I can't see if I can see everybody else down there, but is that Jen? Jen Moan. Senior Vice President for Legal Affairs and the General Counsel, Hofstra University, along with Kathy Hennessy, Senior Vice President for Financial Affairs and Treasurer, Hofstra University. And a very special welcome to Fire Chief Paul Wilders. So before we get started, you're going to hear a little more from some of our other invited guests regarding the history and significance of the White Coat Ceremony. But I want to take a few moments to point out a couple of special circumstances and unique features regarding the Zucker School of Medicine White Coat Ceremony. As many of you may be aware, our students begin their medical school education by becoming licensed EMTs in the state of New York. We chose this path as it provides extremely useful clinical skills, as well as symbolizing our commitment to the integration of clinical medicine and science from the very first minutes of medical school through graduation. It also reminds us of the incredible and unique relationship between Hofstra University and Northwell Health and the resources each shares and contributes. And so, in contrast to most schools who have embraced and performed the White Coat Ceremony, typically in the initial days to weeks of their schooling, we choose to wait until the students have completed their EMT training and licensure. In fact, the title of our first course goes by the acronym CPR, Challenges, Privileges, and Responsibility. We at the Zucker School of Medicine believe that we are supporting and nurturing our students along a transformative path from person to professional. And to celebrate the first step on this journey, we perform the White Coat Ceremony at this time rather than in the earliest days of school because they have earned this privilege. So I'd like to invite to the podium our President Susan Poser at Hofstra University to welcome you and please say a few words. Now, President Poser has always been very supportive and gracious with her time despite a busy schedule and responsibilities to participate in all our special events, not only here at the School of Medicine, but throughout the university, in support of students and faculty. President Poser.
Well, good afternoon and welcome to the White Coat Ceremony of the Donald and Barbara Zucker School of Medicine at Hofstra Northwell. I'm honored to participate in this momentous day to congratulate you and your families and wish you well in the next big step to becoming a physician. Today, the medical profession welcomes you into a noble community of service, a community that needs you now, right here at home and around the world. In truth, as you sit here, you're already in this community, as was just explained, as trained EMTs who have already cared for people in need. So you might say you're being welcomed as colleagues. This is the only one of the things that sets this medical school apart as an extraordinary place to study medicine, and you will experience many more, I promise. Today you receive your white coat, a symbol of humanism, that healthcare is all about people in need. In a few moments, you will pledge to keep healthcare human and to care for your patients with dignity, compassion, empathy, and respect. As you take that oath, may you be encouraged and reassured by all of these people who surround you here today, as well as those who could maybe not be here in person, that you will be very well supported in this journey. Along with your family members, friends, mentors, faculty, peers, and the entire community at Hofstra University, we are here to support you throughout this passage as you become physicians. We are genuinely excited for you, excited to get to know you, and already very proud of you. So on behalf of Hofstra University, I congratulate you as physicians in training, and I look forward to following your progress and seeing you on campus over the coming years. Thank you.
I'd now like to invite to the podium Dr. Kathy Reeves, the President and CEO of the Gold Foundation, to give a history of the Gold Foundation, the White Coat Ceremony, and her vision for the future. This is, again, a special privilege to have the President participate and address our students and faculty. Our partners at the Gold Foundation have been incredibly supportive, and we truly appreciate that partnership. And I can assure you that this is a very special opportunity to hear directly from Dr. Reeves.
Good afternoon, Dean Battinelli, President Poser, my good friend, founding Dean Smith, faculty, families, friends, and most importantly, all of you future doctors. Thank you so much, first, for having the ceremony, for being such great partners with the Gold Foundation, and for inviting me here to share a few words. And to the students, I want to say you are very fortunate. You have joined a wonderful school. I know humanism will be central to your education. So I have the great opportunity to share with you a little bit about Arnold P. Gold and what the Gold Foundation is all about. Arnold was a pediatric neurologist from Columbia University. He and his wife, Sandra, really built this foundation. I want to start with a story from when Arnold was himself a medical student. Arnold completed medical school at the University of Lausanne in Switzerland. And to complete your degree there, you may be happy you didn't go there when I tell you this. To complete your degree there, you had to stand in the theater of the round with a patient surrounded by faculty, other students, and members of the community, and talk with the patient and correctly diagnose what was wrong with them. And most often, the diagnosis would be very complicated and very rare. So it was Arnold's turn. He is standing in the middle of this theater of the round, starting to talk to his patient, listening to everything they have to say, asking question after question, and he's getting really nervous, because he can't figure out anything rare. It all seems way too simple. There's nothing standing out at him. He thinks he's gonna fail. And then the patient's voice starts getting quieter and quieter. And he says, lean in, lean in. So Arnold thinks, oh, there's something. It's something about the volume of his voice. Starts thinking about what could be this really rare disease. So Arnold leans in, and the patient says, I have pneumonia, they're trying to trick you. So, usually not quite so literal, but Arnold was all about the patient being central. And he would use this story to tell his students, there's nothing more important than listening to your patient. They really do have the answer. So the foundation that Arnold and Sandra created embarked on a mission to change healthcare. And I'm going to tell you another story. I only have three, I promise. Another story just about how it all started, how the Gold Foundation started. So Arnold's a pediatric neurologist, so he's with a group of students and residents. He's rounding on the floor. And they're standing outside of the room of a 14-year-old young man who has a brain cancer, a glioblastoma. The residents present the young man's vital signs, they present his physical exam, they present all the medications he's on, all the tests he's had, everything about his medical history. And Arnold says, that's great, really good. Now tell me about him. How has his life changed? And they look at each other and say, well, we don't know, we're not sure. And then he says, okay, does he have brothers and sisters? How are his parents doing? They can't answer him. So Arnold's a little frustrated, but he said, that's okay. You know what, we're gonna go in together and we're gonna use this as a learning opportunity to make sure you're listening to the patient. And he says, what's his name? And nobody knows. So there's something wrong with medical education. Because of this experience and many others like it, Arnold and Sandra created this ceremony, the white coat ceremony, that has become a rite of passage for medical students when they enter medical training. For Arnold and Sandra, waiting until medical school graduation was way too late for you to take an oath about promising to treat the people you're going to have the privilege of working with compassion and dignity, to be collaborative with them, and to give them your very best and make sure they get the most scientifically excellent care. So remember that. That's what this is really about. The white coat's to remind you of the oath you're just about to take. It is all about the oath. And then Arnold and Sandra went on and they began recognizing exemplars in humanism that could be champions and leaders. They created the Gold Humanism Honor Society, which you all have a chance to be a part of, which really recognizes students who are champions for humanism and who are the people that will be the change agents to make it better. And then over the next two decades, the foundation continued to develop lots of programs, create educational tools to improve connections, supported work and research by trainees around humanism, around its importance in healthcare. Partnered with national organizations, partnered with almost every medical school in the country, as well as international schools, nursing schools, corporations connected to healthcare who are also committed to humanism. The Gold Humanism Honor Society has grown to almost 50,000 members, and over 90% of the medical schools across this country are our partners. So now it's time for the next leg of our journey. So I've been here, I don't know, like 110 days now, I think, in this job. And I came to the Gold Foundation because I am dedicated to practical evidence-based solutions that bring health equity, justice, and humanism to everyone, including those in our most marginalized communities. I am here today with my leadership partner, Dr. Elizabeth Cleek, who is the Chief Operating Officer and directs all of our programs. Together, we want to take the next step to help make humanism the standard of care, that compassion, collaboration, and scientific excellence are what happens every time you enter a room with a patient. So my last story is to highlight where we're going. So a really excellent pediatric resident was seeing, I'm a pediatrician by the way, pediatric hospitalist, and the resident was seeing a patient in the emergency room. This was a 2-week-old boy from North Philadelphia. His grandfather brought him in because he had a fever. Now, as you're going to learn in your pediatric rotation, a two-week-old with a fever is at very serious risk for infections. So there was a number of different diagnostic tests that had to be done, including a spinal tap, to make sure the child didn't have meningitis. The resident explains in detail to the grandfather how the spinal tap's going to be done, talks about how the grandfather will have to wait outside the room while they do the procedure. The grandfather is his legal guardian, and he listens intently, and he agrees to everything except the spinal tap. And the resident said, but you have to do the spinal tap. That's what your grandson needs. His life is in danger. And the grandfather says, no. And the resident says, but we have to do it. And you can see what happens. And it escalates, and it escalates. And the resident is at his wit's end. He wants to do what's best for this family. And he says to the grandfather, if you don't let me do it, I'm going to have to file child abuse charges against you. And he comes out of the room, and he calls his attending physician. Attending physician comes down, listens to everything that the resident is saying, agrees completely with the medical plan, but says, but before we do anything, just let me go talk to the grandfather. Do you know what that attending asked the grandfather? Why don't you want the spinal tap? And the grandfather very clearly said, because I don't know if you're going to be taking out the fluid or putting medicine in. I don't trust doctors. Doctors experiment on people and don't tell anybody. My job is to protect my grandson. So the attending says, what if you come in while we do it and you watch and you make sure that we just take fluid out and don't put anything in? And he looks directly into the attending's eyes and says, okay, doc, but only if you do it. People are not dying unnecessarily within our health systems because we don't know which antibiotic to give or we don't know which procedure is needed. People are dying because they don't often feel cared for. In a recent study in JAMA, as high as 80%, imagine that, 8 out of every 10 people admit they don't disclose important information to their doctor because they either feel like their doctor or healthcare professional isn't present, they feel like they're going to be judged by what they say, or they don't feel like the person really cares about them. Young healthcare professionals like you are wonderful, caring people, so where's the disconnect? Our next chapter in the Gold Foundation is going to be about working with partners like Northwell, like Hofstra, to create spaces in our clinics, on our floors, that are human-centered, that take the context of the healthcare professional and the patient and the family and the community into account. I look forward to the day when you hear a patient's address and it means something to you, because that's part of their story. Humanism will improve health. It will decrease health worker burnout. It will increase trust. It will improve how patients and families connect with their caregivers. It will save money, and it will save lives. So with that, I want to share two last thoughts with you, just a little bit of advice. First, I have always worked to make one assumption in my medical career. And that assumption is that everybody in front of you wants to be healthy. If parents want their children to be healthy, if there's something in the way of that, it's not because they're bad people. It's because there's something in the way of that. And your job is to figure that out. And second, I'm going to ask you to commit to learning what you need to learn so that you're able to create a space for your patients where they feel safe enough, cared for enough, trusting enough to share with you the parts of their story that will help you help them. This means learning about their lives, about their community. It also means learning about yourself, about your biases, and how to stay well yourself so that you are in the best position you can be to help someone else. So again, I'm very grateful to have had the chance to come. I will always remember this as my very first white coat speech as the president and CEO of the Gold Foundation. Congratulations on today and all that is to come. Pay close attention to those words when you're saying that oath. Work hard, take care of yourselves, take care of each other, and help keep healthcare human. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Reeves, and it truly is a very special time for you as this is her first address at a white coat ceremony, and I think everybody is very clear on why she is the next leader of the Gold Foundation. So thank you very much. Okay, now for the ceremony. And let me just go over some details because it gets a little complicated and there are a lot of people involved because it is really a very special time for the faculty to participate in this event. So calling up our students so they can receive their white coats will be Dr. Rona Waldenberg, our Associate Dean for Admissions, Dr. Zainab Nasrallah, our Assistant Professor of Science Education, Dr. David Sanchez, a Clinical Assistant Professor of Pediatrics and an ICE Preceptor, and Dr. Gabrielle Goldberg, the Associate Professor of Science Education. Coding the students will be Dr. Taranjit Ahuja, Director of the Humanities and Medicine Curriculum, Dr. Carmen Rodriguez, our Faculty Advisor of the Gold Humanism Chapter. After receiving their coats, they will receive a pin to wear on their white coats from both the Gold Foundation representing humanism and medicine and a pin representing their completion of the New York State EMT course from Dr. Susan Poser and Dr. Ellen Perlman. Ellen is our Associate Dean for Professionalism and Doctoring Skills, and Susan Poser, as you know, the President of Hofstra University. Before I ask our students to rise and acknowledge everyone who is here today, and please give all your guests and supporters a hearty ovation.
Hello, so let's get this party started, as we say. All right, so Aaron Abizadeh and Louis Aganwa. Armando Alvarez Suarez and Vivek Anadatta. Rachel Aronoff and Danila Babushkin. Jared Bassett and Dylan Brown. Ethan Brown and Hannah Buxton. Samantha Catalano and Kelly Centeno. Bianca Chandler and Elaine Chin. Andrew Krecka Jr. and Vijay Gyoprasad. Melissa Durrell and Jake Diamond. Robert Dinallo and Sonny Dizon. Brianna Donnelly and Cole Dutton. Vincent Eng and Esther Fadumier. Daniel Fedita and Trey Feldeisen. And now I pass it over to my colleague, Dr. Nazarella.
Jayanne Forrest and Kate Frieda. Ryan Greenstein and Jason Hoff. Alec Haber and Ephraim Hathaway. Jamila Hazard and Benjamin Ho. Kelly Shu and Senya Huda. Saria Indu Curry and Ivory Jean Paul. Mackenzie Johnson and Brooke Jewell. Divya Kaluri and Sruti Katakam. Vikan Kazar and Alexis Kim. James Kim and Josh Kim. Joy Kim and Benjamin Koenig. James Lee and Priscilla Lee. E. Miss Lee. Okay, now I'll pass it on to Dr. David Sanchez.
Good afternoon, everyone. Alisa Liu and Kevin Liu. Curtis Long, L. Ren Liu. Opera Team Mighty, Charles Milliken. Nicholas Moriton, Sandra Marangelo. David Murtha, Derek Wynn. John O'Hare Jr., Kadir Osler. Nicole Park, Lismari Peña Perez. Stephen Papula, Luke Powers. Adrian Puentes, Samantha Puglisi. Rahul Ramanathan, Manuel Ramos. Kavya Rao, Emily Ronan. Alex Rosenberg, Stephanie Rothberg. Last but not least, I'll pass it on to my colleague, Dr. Gabrielle Goldberg.
Maya Sachs, Juan San Pedro III. Austin Schultz, Matthew Scaglione. Ilya Shaw, Nicole Sherman. Sophia Silverman, Brandon Smith. Eric Song, Audrey Sue. Kashvia Suri, Tasnia Tabasum. Riley Thompson, Derek Tran. Mariana Du and Tiana Vasquez. Elizabeth Weber, Ruby Wiener. Greer Williams, Kristen Winkle. Michael Sia, April Yu. Nikki Zand, Jeffrey Zhang Sun. And Andrew Jung.
Congratulations, everyone. Someone always has to be last. We're getting very efficient at this. And now I'd like to call up Dr. Jennifer Merez, our Associate Dean for Faculty Affairs, to come to the podium. Ask that all our students and faculty and all physicians present please rise and join in as Dr. Merez leads the recitation of the Hippocratic Oath, adapted and edited by the inaugural Zucker School of Medicine class, and will also be repeated at graduation. Dr. Merez.
Thank you, and congratulations to everyone. So please follow along with me and repeat after me. I swear to fulfill to the best of my ability and judgment this covenant.
I swear to fulfill to the best of my ability and judgment this covenant.
I will respect the hard-won scientific gains of those physicians in whose steps I walk and gladly share such knowledge as is mine with those who are to follow. Apply for the benefit of the sick all measures that are required, avoiding those twin traps of overtreatment and therapeutic nihilism. I will remember that there is art to medicine as well as science, and that warmth, sympathy, and understanding may outweigh the surgeon's knife or the chemist's drug. I will not be ashamed to say I know not, nor will I fail to call in my colleagues when the skills of another are needed for a patient's recovery.
I will not be ashamed to say I know not, nor will I fail to call in my colleagues when the skills of another are needed.
will respect the privacy of my patients, for their problems are not disclosed to me that the world may know. Most especially must I tread with care in matters of life and death and never abuse the power that has been bestowed upon me. I will remember that I do not treat a fever chart, a cancerous growth, but a sick human being whose illness may affect not only the person, but a family and community. I will prevent disease whenever I can, for prevention is preferable to cure. I will remember that I remain a member of society with special obligations to all of my fellow human beings, those sound of mind and body, as well as the infirm. I will maintain the health of my own mind, body, and spirit, so I'm able to discharge my duties appropriately. If I do not violate this oath, may I enjoy life and art, respected while I live and remembered with affection thereafter. May I always act so as to preserve the finest traditions of my calling, and may I long experience the joy of healing those who seek my help. Congratulations.
Okay, we're getting closer to the celebration part. So before we do, I want to say a special thanks to all the staff who worked tireless to help put this together over here at the Marriott. And please invite everybody here back to the School of Medicine, where we're going to have a celebration for the afternoon. But you can gather a little bit outside the hotel if you like for a little while to make sure that you catch up with all your significant others before we head back over. So again, thanks to everybody who participated, a special thanks to Dr. Reeves, all our guests, and one last round of applause for our students.